Welcome to the latest Gramophone Podcast. I'm Martin Cullingford, editor of Gramophone, and it's a real pleasure today to be joined by violinist Leonidas Kavakos to talk about his new recording, the complete Solo Violin Sonatas and Partitas by Bach, available from Sony Classical. It's a very powerful performance of them, and clearly a very personal one. But then all performances of these extraordinary works will be. I mean, they're considered by artists and audiences alike to be among the most profound works in all music, and certainly right there at the summit of the violin repertoire. I mean, a place to begin, what do you think accounts for their power and impact for both players and listeners?
Well, I mean, this does not concern only the violin repertoire, but in a way, whatever Bach writes has this, it brings anybody who either plays or listens to the music, let's say, the closest possible to an imaginatory perfection. Mm. So, in other words, his music, you know, is so rich in every respect that one might try to approach it, whether it is, you know, simply speaking about melodies, about harmonies, about rhythms, or if one wants to go a bit further about the challenges of the different forms and how to adopt his ideas and the complexity of his thoughts and sounds into the whatever instrument he's writing, whether it is violin, piano, or if it is an orchestral piece. So, for instance, when you think of the violin sonatas and partitas, of course, the amazing element here is the fact that, as he says it, you know, he's writing six wonderful big works for violin solo without accompaniment, without bass, without practically any help. And the violin, which is an instrument that is even today mostly appreciated and loved as a melodic instrument, when we are, you know, looking at Bach sonatas and partitas, we're not talking about only a melodic instrument, but we're talking about an instrument that all of a sudden becomes very polyphonic while being melodic, an instrument that can handle fugues, an instrument that can handle, for instance, if we look at the andante of the second sonata, two voices, that one is the main voice and the accompanying voice at the same time in a melodic movement, or at the same time, we can have an instrument that creates, let's say, wonderful dancing spirit, you know, in the movements that are mostly the partitas, where, you know, we have all these different kinds of dances going on, slower, faster. So in a way, you know, he when you look, for instance, even later, then this is what is I find extremely amazing about Bach and violin. Let's stay to this now. That even if you look at later in the repertoire of the violin, when we look at it, it's mostly treated as a melodic instrument, and wonderfully. But even with composers that were very symphonic in their writing, who developed the form of concerto, for instance. We have, for instance, Brahms, if we take a great example, or Beethoven, who write wonderful music for the violin, but it's always music that is, the violin is more or less a singing voice. Mm-hmm. And we have few exceptions later on that come in the 20th century, especially with people like Isaïe, who was, of course, a great violinist of the time, and who heard the live performance of Sigeti playing the Bach sonatas and partitas, and went home, was so inspired, and he himself wrote six sonatas for violin solo. Or even later, the great Béla Bartók, who writes one of the greatest masterpieces, the Bartók solo sonata, where, of course, again, the violin is really, I think this is probably the closest that anybody came to Bach writing the Bartók solo sonata. But if we take this away, there is very little. There were many attempts. There were attempts by Reger. There were attempts by Prokofiev, other composers who did write for solo violin, but nobody really reached that kind of level of Bach. And this is something that is really amazing, because we know that all of these composers that I mentioned, they all knew and they all studied Bach. All of them knew him, knew his music, loved the music, were incredible admirers. They learned from his works. Yet nobody was able to master something like you know, like write a violin solo piece that would be so complete and so, as I said before, close to perfection. Not because I judge what perfection is, but because I don't know and nobody knows what perfection is. So if we imagine perfection, we think of Bach. So it is. I find this rather fascinating, because he had the ability to do anything he wanted for any instrument. I mean, the way he writes for the, even for the organ, the way he writes for the piano of the time, the way he writes his orchestra, his cantatas, all of this, you know, it's all very challenging for the voice. It's challenging for the instruments, even the orchestral piece, you know. And he writes, you know, all the time. It's an enormous, how can I say? It's a time where every piece practically breaks a limit, which is absolutely fascinating when you imagine how many works Bach wrote. It's absolutely mind-blowing. So I am still, you know, I've been always, and of course now even more so, fascinated by this amazing and incomparable inventive writing that Bach could produce, and which is never done for the purpose of writing. You don't see that, because when you listen to the music, you start traveling. There is something else there that takes you with it. So, but yet when you actually try to isolate that and look at the score, or really look at the music he has written from the instrumental point of view, it is incredible how difficult and challenging and demanding it is. And I think nobody else in history equaled this kind of achievement.
Not unrelated to what you've just been talking about, as a violinist, unlike, you know, say, a pianist, almost all your music making is collaborative, that you're collectively finding a musical journey and vision with other people, whether concertos or chamber music. And here it is just you. And you've obviously talked about how Bach managed to write just for solo violin. But can you talk a bit about what the experience is like for you, how the experience for you as a musician differs playing these to almost all of the other music that you play, i.e. solo rather than collaborative?
That's a very very good question. And also it obliges me for my answer to go quite back. Why I'm saying this, because I, of course, as a student, as a violin student, I started quite early with Bach. So more or less everybody who studies the violin, you know, has to get to know this music, and most of the time early enough. So that was the same thing with me, except that, and I went to competitions, I played it in concert, you know, I had to play Bach everywhere, up to a certain point where I was given a recording as a present. I was given a recording of a Belgian violinist called Sigiswald Kalken. And this is back in the late 80s. So we're talking about a long time ago. And I was given this recording as a present, and by a very good friend in Italy who was a child doctor, but he was one of the greatest record collectors and music connoisseurs that I have met, and who came and told me, look, this is very different, but why don't you listen to this? I really think this is wonderful. And so I listened to this recording and I was just blown away. Why? Because I realized that not only Bach is not what I thought I knew it is, but also because the instrumental side of what was one receiving in the recording was absolutely, I had never heard of something like this before, and it was presenting many, many new ways. What I mean, for instance, the lower tuning. What does it have as an effect? Okay, everybody say, yes, at the time, we most probably believe that this was the right pitch. You know, people used to tune the instruments lower. Perfect. Wonderful. This is the historical side of it. What effect actually does it have acoustically? So to me, it transforms the instrument. First of all, it takes all the romanticism as we know it today away, because already our listening is tuned to a certain kind of frequency.
Yeah.
And also the instrument itself reacts to the tuning in a certain way. And when you go lower, the instrument is not anymore the same thing. It functions acoustically, I mean now, totally different. A. B. The fact that you tune the instrument lower means that there is less pressure from the strings onto the bridge and then naturally onto the instrument. What does that mean? To me, I found that this allows much more space for polyphony, because the fact is that in order to produce a chord, you don't need to press as much, because the strings tuned lower, they have less, they are less stiff, they're more flexible. And then also what I observed was, of course, that then when I heard this recording by Kalken, of course, I knew that he's using a Baroque bow. So that is another side that, of course, historically is correct, but what does it mean in terms of the playing and the way that we approach the music? So I then, when I hear the recording, I liked it so much. I thought, okay, this is it. I stopped playing Bach. That's it. I have to think. I have to study. I have to re-approach. And I have to find then a way that this music will make sense according to what I have just listened to. And I think it really touches me. And so that was a very long process, because we are talking about now, that was early 90s, 91, 92, when I kind of stopped playing the Bach. I started playing again now, like a few years ago. Not because I couldn't do it, but because, you know, I wanted to, this meant, you know, I have to, how can I say, like, imagine, like, we leave Earth and we go to another planet, right? That it's not going to, as soon as you land, you're not going to start doing what you were doing before. You have to, it takes time to adjust, to adopt, to be able to absorb, to see what are your possibilities, how are you going to be able to express this and that. So it is a similar process for me, this way of approaching the music and reapproaching the music rather. And so I, for many years, whenever I played Bach, I used the Baroque bow. I loved the way the instrument is reacting in the lower tuning. I tried the gut strings even, and slowly I formed a new way, for me, a new way, by also discovering different ways of polyphony. What do I mean by that? The way we learn to play the violin is a certain, technically, is a certain way, which, for instance, when it comes to a four-note chord, the division is two and two. This is how more or less everybody learns. If it's a three-note chord, three-voice chord, then there's two possibilities. Either you do all notes together, three at once, or this is the funniest thing, which again made me think a lot, you do two plus two, but two plus two never equals three. So what is there that could be changed? And then I look at the manuscript of Bach, not itself, the facsimile, I mean, and then I see that, for instance, when he writes an accord throughout the sonatas and the partitas, he never writes in the modern way, which means one line and four notes in the same line. No, he will write four different notes vertically, more or less at the same space, but each note is independently written. Whoever has had access to a facsimile and has seen that will know exactly what I mean. Mm-hmm. So to me, when I saw this, I felt, okay, but that means that each note then is a different story, is an independent presence, which means the division of the chords has to be totally different than coupling all the time, whether it's three notes or a four-note chord. So it's never two and two. It can be three plus one, it can be one plus three, it can be one plus two, it can be two plus one plus one, mm. It can be one plus one plus one plus one. So you understand that when I started realizing all these possibilities, that I thought, you know, like somebody throws you into the ocean and tells you, well, find your way to the ground. So you have to start navigating in unknown territory, because I had learned in a specific way, which is the way more or less everybody learns the violin, and I had to change everything. So to me, coming to then closer to the music again and reapproaching from that point of view, that activated a whole different world of playing this music. And what I mean by that is that I found out how to sustain one note in an accord in order to help the listener remember that this is an important note where the music now is actually, is like a bass to that, to the music that we are listening, because there is no bass. But of course, in the writing, there is bass in the violin voices, except that with the violin, as you know, we don't have the pedal, or we cannot keep, one cannot, because the shape of the bridge is like a, how can I say, is a curve. Mm-hmm. We cannot play four strings together, four voices together. That means then we have to present a situation, a virtual situation. That means when I give you an accord of four voices, I have to present it in such a way that the listener can distinguish which voice is the bass, which voice is the important voice in the chord, and what role does it play, especially if we're talking about a fugue, where the voices are moving and the registers, the motif is changing registers all the time. This is extremely difficult. So all this took enormous amount of time, an enormous amount of thinking and practicing and working and recording myself, trying to listen to what I'm doing, until I started finally finding my way, and in a way that I would be happy with the way the music goes. And also for me, it always has been, but even more so with Bach's music, I don't want the listener to listen to the violin. When they listen to my recording, I don't want people to listen to the violin. I want people to listen to the music. I don't want people to listen to how I play. I want people to listen to the music. And how does one do this? One does this by really trying to serve the music, not in terms of being honest and playing all the notes. This, everybody does it, but in terms of serving the roles of the notes. I look at the notes as like actors in a theater play. So everybody has their own line. Mm-hmm. Everybody has their own line, and that line sometimes helps the evolution of the work. Sometimes it supports what's happening. Sometimes it works against. Sometimes, you know, it stays longer than other times. So for me, the voices in the Bach play is exactly that. Each one of them independently has a role, and one has to present the note in such a way that the role can be as much as possible clear to the listener. Mm-hmm. So this, to me, is, to come back to your question, this is for me how I approached and how I am coming to this music now, and why I decided finally that I'm ready to record this music after all these years, because I think that I have, so to say, a new proposal to present. So a proposal to listen to music that has been recorded more or less by everybody, but in a way that it is quite different. In, you will not feel it, because it's not the purpose. The being different is not the purpose. But if one can isolate certain details, one will find that there are quite a few things there that more or less have not been done before. And this concern a way also of facing violin playing from now on, not for the sake of violin playing, but for the sake of serving the music better. So it is, for me, it, you know, through this process of relearning and reapproaching Bach and learning again, you know, how the instrument reacts, how to coordinate the voicing and everything, I think that I have somehow found new energy, lots of new energy, wonderful positive energy for the rest of the music that I'm playing, which is of course what everybody thinks about Bach, because everybody considers Bach to be the, let's say, the beginning of what we today know and love as classical music, although there were people even before Bach that were fantastic. But Bach somehow is, I would say, the how can I say it? It in Bach's music, everything comes together somehow. The fugue the word fuga. I don't know how many people know what exactly it actually means. Fugi in ancient Greek and modern Greek is the same word, and it becomes in Latin fuga, means to leave from somewhere, to escape. And why, of course, is this word chosen? Nobody knows. This would be one of my very first questions if I would ever meet Bach, if I ever dared to articulate one word in front of him, because I think if I saw him, I would just die probably. But if I was ever able to ask him something, I would ask him, this would be definitely one of my very first questions. Why does he give the word fuga to this music? And not only, of course, on the violin, he has written fugues for every instrument. But why is that word there? And for me, it's a personal thing, but it might be interesting to the listeners, is that it's a combination that, you know, this is secular music, supposedly. Yet, the prelude of the third partita, the opening movement of the third partita, is exactly the same music from the Sinfonia in the cantata number 19, which is written then for orchestra, and exactly what the violin plays in the prelude is played by the organ with accompaniment of the orchestra. You can just, anybody can just go on YouTube and put that, you know, and you will hear. And it sounds amazing, because it's also great to understand then, because there Bach writes for the organ as solo, but then there is an orchestra and there is a bass. So there you actually can hear that music with the bass. So you understand what Bach had in mind while he was writing this prelude for the violin where there is no bass. So the title of the cantata is Wir danke dir Gott, which means we thank you God. More religious title one could not have, right? Now, I make this combination now, and this helped me a lot in sorting out the fugues, especially. To me, we know that also the Sonatas and Partitas were written shortly after his wife passed away. There is a title, Sei Solo, which means you are on your own. And there is the third partita with Thank You God in what otherwise is a secular composition. And we have the fugue where we say fugitive, right? You say fugitive is somebody who, it's exactly the same root. Today, in modern Greek, we use it even today. When somebody leaves, we say effie. Fie, effie. If you say to somebody, please leave, you say fie, fuga. It's exactly the same word. And so to me, this has to do, it helped me a lot when I thought about it a bit metaphysically, in what sense, that the motive that changes registers in a fugue, I interpret it as different life incarnations. So you have the same, so to say, soul that lives in different levels, or that its journey through different levels. You can, as you want to interpret it. And for me, the most, shocking element is, and question, was the last chord of the C major fugue. The last chord of C major fugue, mind you that the C major fugue has a very specific form. It has three sections, main sections, or even four, one could say, but let's say three main sections, of which the first and the third are identical. Okay, there is a big, big middle section, which includes the inversion of the theme, but the first section of the fugue and the very last section of the fugue are identical, the last, let's say, 1-2 minutes of the fugue. So, but what happens then is that the last chord, after a 10-minute fugue in C major, he finishes with a C major chord, but he adds on top of that chord the G, the dominant. For me, that was a huge question. What is the role of that note? Because why does he not, in all the other fugues, he finishes, let's say, in the normal way, even though in the A minor fugue, he starts minore and he finishes maggiore. He finishes with a major A major chord, but this is common with Bach. But this with a dominant as the last note of the chord, I could only interpret it in the way that the soul, the existence, returns. and why this is maybe a bit too much, but there is this writer, Boris Muraviev, who wrote a book, a sequence of books about esoteric Christianism. And he speaks about the descending octave of creation. He presents the C major, the C scale of creation, and he gives the different steps. So from C, then to B, to A, to G, F, and so on, going down, of course, it's a descending octave, the creation. And he says that our level, so our world starts, so our C starts in the cosmic dominant, in the cosmic G. So, of course, this anybody can say, okay, that's too much, that's crazy, that's whatever, you know. But what I'm telling you now is something that it is, Boris Muraviev is quite a respected writer, I mean, scientist and so on, quite a respected man. And this theory, I think, is a fantastic one. First of all, it puts the creation of the world into a musical perspective, which is, to me, very much the way it is. Even if we combine it with what Plato says and all the great philosophers of the past. But the fact that he positions our first step of our creation, our C, the beginning of our descending octave, right at the dominant of the cosmic octave, that for me, in combination with the Bach, you can imagine it gave me a fascination that I could not even imagine a few years back. And even until the day when this idea came to my mind, I said, wait a minute, that G, what can it be? The fugue. So we look at the motif traveling from one level to the other, you know, back and forth. So it creates a certain kind of cycle. And then after all this is completed, comes the dominant. So it is very, how can I say, this is why I say that Bach is, I think, is more than just music, in the sense that it awakes all other kinds of senses into a mind and the soul of a person. And I think that's why what I told you is very personal. It's nothing that one can prove in terms of, you know, I say, well, look, this is what it is. No, you cannot say that. But it is a way to approach something that we cannot see. And, you know, where did these people get all this inspiration is also something where we cannot see. I mean, when Bach sat down and wrote 700 cantatas, one each every week, let's not to speak about anything else, but let's 700. It's an enormous, I mean, it's inconceivable. So to him, it was nothing. It was something that was happening very easy. So where was it coming from? When we say, I just got an idea, where did I get the idea from? What is that area, that space where I get this idea? Nobody knows. So that's what I'm saying, that in this way, approaching it in this way, it opened to me totally a new horizon to this music, and also a new perspective to Bach, especially, because then I see that it's you know, he doesn't need romanticism. He doesn't need anything. He doesn't need impressionism. He doesn't need any of this, because that music is already including all of this. Mm-hmm. If you take accords that Bach wrote, you isolate them. There are chords that certain chords you can place in the Romantic era, certain chords that you can place in Impressionistic era. You know, you can isolate elements and put them, you know, in other times when music was not written such music yet. But with Bach, you have everything there. So there is a very, very, very universal dimension to Bach's music that I feel many of our listeners might find that they agree with. And that is, I think, Bach, in a way, purifies the soul, the music of Bach. And that's exactly why.
The close of the fugue from Bach's Sonata for Solo Violin No. 3 in C major, performed by our guest today, Leonidas Kavakos. is taken from his recording of the complete Sonatas and Partitas for Solo Violin by Bach, which is available now from Sony Classical. Thank you for downloading this Gramophone podcast, and if you enjoyed it, there are many more episodes to be found. Simply search for Gramophone where you usually find your podcasts. The latest issue of the magazine, featuring an interview with our cover artist Joyce DiDonato, is available now. And if you'd like to subscribe to the magazine, either in print or digitally, all listeners to our podcast can get a 20% discount off any subscription package. Simply visit gramophone.co.uk/subscribe and enter the code podcast20 at the checkout. And do join us next week for another Gramophone podcast.